I've been gone for a couple weeks, and it's just good to be back in the house. It's good to be here fellowshipping with you. So let's jump in here. Father, I just thank you for the word that you've given me to speak this morning. I just thank you that it doesn't fall on any deaf ears, but Father, it's received into the heart, Father, right into the spirit of the men and women sitting here, anybody watching online. Father, I thank you for the power of your word that divides the bone and marrow, soul and spirit. Mm-hmm. Father, we thank you that you've designed your word to be so entwined with us that we begin to live it, that we begin to be it. Father, we thank you for your word. Amen. Amen. You know, I did see something in worship earlier. Is there someone here with some neck pain? You got neck pain? No, Rachel? And Nate? You guys? Just really quick. Just really quick. I just saw it leaving, so I want it to leave. Yeah? All right. Thank you, Father. Just go right now. Father, I thank you for healing. Healing right now. Heal that neck. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for that neck. Speak healing into it now. My God. Just begin to roll it. Thank you, Father. Speak healing into this neck. Well, you like that, huh? Is it good?
It's good.
It's good. How's it going? Your neck? Okay. Okay. So we're just going to tell anxiety to go. It has no place. No place in your life. No place in your body. Because that's what this stuff does. Anxiety, depression, it actually affects your body. It's on you. It comes on you. It pushes on you. Pressurizes you. It's got to go. Okay? So right now, Father, I just thank you for Christy. Thank you for her life. We just cast off all anxiety right now. And we thank you, Father, for freedom in her spirit. Amen. Amen. Yeah, you're welcome. Anybody have a hip issue too? Some? Rachel, come here. I know that I said the miracle signs and wonders, like follow the word, but today it's going to be different. You too? Okay. All right. Can you sit down there, Rachel? Put your back square against that chair. Just push right back into it. Yep. Nice. Oh, they're good. Thank you, Father. Father, just touch this hip.
Yes.
Thank you right now, Father, for healing. Right now. All over. Thank you for your blueprint, Father. Your blueprint of heaven just to come down into this body. You don't have any inserts in, do you? See that leg's a little short?
Yeah.
Yeah, just come up. Right now. Thank you, Father. There it is. Yep. Thank you, Father, for healing. Thank you, Father, for healing. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Both my legs are short. Can you help that?
Both your legs are short. You're just a short person. That's... Bless Karen. Bless Karen. Just bless Karen. Bless her with some height. You too. Come on. All right.
Here we go. Let me see. Yeah. Oh, see, your leg's a little short there, too. Karen, you ready?
Ready.
Yeah, see, watch this. Come on out, leg. It's right there. Come on out. Come on out. You're almost there. Thank you, Father. Put your back right into the seat there. Oh, yeah. Just grow out right now, Jesus. We thank you, Father, for healing in that hip. Heal that hip. Heal that hip. Right there. Good stuff.
It is.
Good stuff. Here, stand up.
It worked. I'm 6'1". I'm going out for the WBA.
Okay, WNBA. Kara, she's Pinocchio too. She says her nose is growing. Oh my goodness. Who says you can't have fun at church? Lord, I need to recover now. Wow.
Praise God, he's so good.
He is so good. So good. We love it. We love it. Well, today is Palm Sunday. Thought I'd throw that out there. See what happens. So I didn't grow up Catholic. I have always grown up in more of a Pentecostal, a charismatic setting. But I love the holidays, and I noticed that Google is posting these things on my calendar, like Holy Saturday and, you know, different things. And I'm like, oh, wow, let's look this up. So I was looking up Palm Sunday, and the palm is actually pretty powerful. It's pretty powerful. It's very symbolic. It's symbolic of victory is what it's symbolic of. Mm-hmm. And I want to talk about that in just a second. But so there was, it said on the fifth Sunday, like I said, I didn't grow up Catholic, and maybe, Barry, you can help me. But are you Catholic?
No way.
You weren't? Wow. Wrong person. So on the fifth Sunday of Lent, it was Passion Sunday, right? Oh, Dan, you can help me with this, right? Passion Sunday, right? And then there was Palm Sunday, and then you have Easter, right? Resurrection Sunday. So in 1969, I think the diocese, they like combined Passion and Palm.
I'm still a little too young for that.
Too young for that, okay. So they combine these things. So today is actually Passion Sunday. I like that.
Yeah, I like it.
Just a side note, put it out there. So anyway, but the palm, I want to read, if you can turn with me inside of John 12. I want to read this because I think that it's so powerful. What I'd like to talk about today is a little bit of humility. Humility. Because humility and humbleness before God is going to reveal so much. God's going to give you, as long as you can stay humble before God, he's going to be able to reveal things to you, your mission in your life, all the missions he has lined up for you. Amen?
Yeah.
And this is it goes right along with, you know, Palm Sunday, if you will. But I just thought it was so amazing. And I want to start in verse 1 because this is, it's where I want to start. Verse 1, 6 days before the Passover began, and I'm in the Passion Translation. You can read whatever you like. 6 days before the Passover began, Jesus went back to Bethany, the town where he raised Lazarus from the dead. They had prepared a supper for Jesus. Martha served, and Lazarus and Mary were among those at the table. Mary picked up the alabaster jar full of nearly a liter of extremely rare and costly perfume, the purest extract of nard. And she anointed Jesus' feet. It messes me up every time I read it. Then she wiped them down with her long hair, and the fragrance of the costly oil filled the house. But Judas the locksmith, his last name was Iscariot, and it meant key, lock. So a lot of times, you know, last names would associate with that. Anyway, Simon's son, the betrayer, spoke up and said, "What a waste. We could have sold this perfume for a fortune and give the money to the poor." In fact, Jesus had no heart for the poor. Jesus had a heart for the poor. Sorry, I probably put my glasses on. Stop crying. In fact, Judas had no heart for the poor. He only said this because he was a thief and in charge of the money case. he would steal money whenever he wanted from the funds given to support Jesus' ministry. Jesus said to Judas, "Leave her alone. She has saved it for the time of my burial. You'll always have the poor with you, but you won't always have me." When the word got out that Jesus was not far from Jerusalem, a large crowd came out to see him. And they also wanted to see Lazarus, the man Jesus had raised from the dead. This prompted the chief priest to seal the plans to do away with both Jesus and Lazarus. Pretty wild. For his miracle testimony was irrefutable and was persuading many of the Jews living in Jerusalem to believe in Jesus. Isn't that powerful? There's a whole dinner, there's a whole ceremony before he even rides in on this donkey into Jerusalem. And I just find it so amazing that he knows what's about to happen to him. He knows that he's about to rescue you. He knows that he's about to rescue me. He's so humble. He's so humble. He knows what he's about to do, and he's willing to do it. Are you? That's my question this morning is, are you? I mean, there's a lot of times you can't expect everything, but there's sometimes we know what we're walking into. We know there's a hard conversation we're walking into with somebody. We know that whatever it is, and it's, do you have the humility in your life to walk into that and be a servant? And be a servant. Sometimes we need to, what do they say, eat a piece of humble pie or whatever? It's true. Now, Jesus is in this scenario, willing to die, willing to ride in on a donkey. I was reading that as kings would conquer other territories, they would ride in with their war horses and chariots. And Jesus was about to conquer something. But because he was the King of Peace, he rides in side saddle on a donkey. How humble. Even hanging on the cross, he could call down whatever he needed to call down to get him out of that place, to rescue him from that place. But instead, he decided to rescue you. Isn't it good? He decided to rescue you. Let's keep reading here. Wow. The next day, the news that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem swept through the massive crowd gathered for the feast. So they took palm branches and went out to meet him. Everyone was shouting, "Lord, be our Savior." You might say, "Hosanna." "Blessed is the one who comes to us from Yahweh, God, the King of Israel." See, people are starting to understand this. They're starting to see this movement. The Pharisees are always going to try to stop you. They're always going to try to stop you. And what do you need? You need humility, but you need persuasion. Are you persuaded? Are you persuaded that God is your Father? Are you persuaded in your identity? Or do you waver? We have got to stop wavering. We have got to stop wavering. Just stop wavering. I'm telling you, in worship, I mean, just begin to raise your hands. Just begin to worship. Just begin to cry. Begin to laugh. But whatever happens, happens. Let God happen in your life. Let God happen in your life. There were so many moments in worship this morning that I just was completely wrecked and lost. I just want to, Brad, thanks for singing "He Loves Us." Oh, people always want to change that word, sloppy wet kiss. I tell them, get lost, man. God can kiss me any way he wants. Because he's gonna. I can't stop it. You know what I mean? Like, my heart was turning so violently inside of my chest. And then Bree singing, "I am because he is." She wrote that song. And I bet even out of her own testimony, something she was going through, "I am because he is." Yeah. Terry Ross just preached that amazing message here a while back. But are you persuaded? Are you persuaded that you're one with the I am? Are you persuaded in your identity so much that you're willing to live that humble life? Wow, God, you're so good. Verse 14 says, "Then Jesus found a young donkey and rode on it to fulfill what was prophesied. People of Zion, have no fear. Look, it's your king." I can't stop. "Coming to you, riding on a young donkey." Now, Jesus' disciples didn't fully understand the importance of what was taking place, but after he was raised and exalted into glory, they understood how Jesus fulfilled all the prophecies in the scriptures. I'm sorry, that said all. Did you hear that? Jesus fulfilled all prophecy in the scripture that were written about him. All the eyewitnesses of the miracle miracle Jesus performed when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead kept spreading the news about Jesus to everyone. The news of this miracle of resurrection caused the crowds to swell as great numbers of people welcomed him into the city with joy. But the Pharisees were disturbed by this and said to each other, "We won't be able to stop this." The whole world is going to run after him.
Wow.
And that's what's happening now.
Yes.
That's what's happening right now. The whole world is running after him. Stop trying to run away from him. He's running after you. He wants you. He wants you to be one with him. He wants you to feel the same presence of the Father as he feels. He wants you to feel the same exact power that he feels. He wants you to be exalted just like him. Wow. This palm branch, though. This palm branch. The palm branch tree is a symbol of triumph, victory over death. Why? You know where palm trees grow?
Orlando.
Yep, they're there too. But in the middle of the desert, they overcome the arid climate. They bloom and blossom with no water. So the palm branch, the palm tree, has always been a symbol of triumph, overcoming, all throughout the scripture. Let's go to Revelation 7. I'll show you there too. Revelation. You're like, "No, I don't want to go there." It's okay. Don't be afraid. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ. If you actually read the whole title to the book, Revelation of Jesus Christ, given to John. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Now, Jesus was riding into Jerusalem to do what was prophesied, and this was for the for Israel, right? It was for all mankind, but he was prophesying, though he was fulfilling the prophecy of Israel. Now in Revelation 7, verse 9, it says, "After this, I looked, and behold, right in front of me, I saw a vast multitude of people, an enormous multitude, so huge that no one could count, made up of victorious ones from every nation, tribe, people group, and language. They were all in glistening white robes, standing before the throne and before the Lamb with palm branches in their hands. And they shouted out with a passionate voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, seated on the throne and the Lamb." All the angels were standing in a circle around the throne with the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen, praise and glory, wisdom and thanksgiving, honor, power, and might belong to our God forever and ever. Amen." I was reading that scripture this morning, Barry, and all I could hear was Bob Mensah singing that song. Praise and glory, wisdom and thanks, honor and power and strength be to our God. Remember that song? And ever be to our God. So in here you can see it coming to pass for all nations, all tribes, all people groups. Amen. Oh. Now, I want to turn over to 1 Peter 5, and Peter kind of starts to crush a little pride here, and he calls out for humility himself. 1 Peter 5, verse 1. Thank you, Father. It says, "Now I encourage you as an elder, as an eyewitness of the sufferings of Christ, and one who shares in the glory that is about to be unveiled. I urge you, fellow elders among you, to be compassionate shepherds who tenderly care for God's flock and who feed them well." Excuse me. "For you have the responsibility to guide, protect, and oversee. Consider it a joyous pleasure and not merely a religious duty. Lead from your heart under God's leadership, not as a way to gain finances dishonestly, but as a way to eagerly and cheerfully serve. Don't be controlling tyrants, but lead others by your beautiful examples to the flock." I'm talking to parents too right now. I'm talking to people that have kids, oversee people at work. Don't be tyrants.
Amen. It's good.
Yeah. Yeah. Lead in love. Yeah. Mm-hmm. "And when the Shepherd King appears, you will win the victor's crown of glory that never fades away. In the same way, younger ones should willingly support." Your translation may say submit. I love the Passion Translation. They use this word that support there. It's also, you find that with wives submitting to your husbands. It's a support. The word submit doesn't exist there. It's support. We're support to one another.
Right.
If you want to submit to something, submit to God.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. I don't want my wife to submit to me. I want her to support me.
Yeah.
I need support.
Yeah.
I need pillars in my life.
Yeah.
You need pillars in your life. Where are your pillars? Those are your support pillars. It's so easy when you start to think that word submit is just, the English language has been so entangled inside of the Greek. It's so sad. Because we have to keep mining. Isn't it wonderful though? Who was I just talking with? Somebody the other day. And I was talking about the Bible. It's the oldest book. It's like, that's the reason the printing press. Was that Michael? It was you, right? So Mike and I were at breakfast the other morning, and we're talking about the Bible. We're talking about, like, the oldest book. But the thing is, like, you can keep mining out new things every time you read. Tell me one other book that you can do that with. Please, I mean, seriously. It's like, the words are written there. You take it literal. You have an image in your head, right? You get into the scriptures, and you can read scripture after scripture. Have one thing, go back and read the scripture, have another thing. It's so beautiful. It's meant to keep illuminating things to you. The Spirit illuminates things to you, shows you things. So this word submit, it's support. support the leadership of the elders. In every relationship, each of you must wrap around yourselves the apron of a humble servant, because God resists you when you're proud, but multiplies grace and favor when you're humble. If you bow low in God's presence, awesome presence, he will eventually exalt you as you leave the timing in his hands. Pour out all your worries and stress upon him and leave them there. Leave them there. So even Christy, leave it there. You gave it to him. Anxiety, it's over there. It's not yours. Don't take it back. Promise? Actually, the word says promise no man anything but to love him. So don't promise me anything. Just leave it over there. Yeah. Because he tenderly cares for you. Be well balanced and always alert, because your enemy, the devil, roams around incessantly like a roaring lion looking for its prey to devour. Take a decisive stand against him and resist him, his every attack, with strong, vigorous faith. For you know that your believing brothers and sisters around the world are experiencing the same kinds of troubles and endure. Now, you have to realize that this is written, the context of this. Christians were being persecuted and martyred and just murdered all over the place. Just being hunted down. And Peter's telling them to be humble. And then after your brief suffering, the God of all loving grace, who has called you to share in his eternal glory in Christ, will personally and powerfully restore you and make you stronger than ever. Yes, he will set you firmly in place and build you up. And he has all the power needed to do this forever. Amen. And just want to go back to this part here about the being well balanced and always alert, because your enemy, the devil, roams around incessantly like a roaring lion looking for its prey to devour. Now, I don't know what you have pictured in your head when it comes to this scenario, but I want you to picture it right now, whatever it is. Like, what's this roaring lion? Like, I've talked about it before. It's nice that it's roaring because you're like hearing it, right? It's off in the distance. Not so worried about it, but how does this lion devour you? How does the lion devour you? Well, you hear the roaring lion, you start to get afraid. Okay? So, number one, he starts to devour you with the spirit of fear. Spirit of fear comes in, and then you start to feel anxiety. You start to feel depressed. You start to feel, and begins to devour you. This is all metaphoric. It's no crazy lion that's just going to come and rip your head off. It's talking about spiritual realm stuff here. There's things that you're hearing that you could be participating with in the spirit that you need to run from. You need to run from. There is a roaring lion, and you hear the roar, but you're still standing there. The point is to leave the situation. What situation are you in right now that you need to leave? Leave. The roaring lion is making a sound. Spirit of fear wants to have a grip. That's why it says, with strong, vigorous faith. Leave it behind. Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
I love that. I'm going to go over to the Mirror Translation real quick. And he's got a couple scriptures in there. 1 Peter 5, 7. 7 and 8. It says, 1 Peter 5, 7. Take immediate action when it comes to distractions and cares. Take immediate action. Right? Cast off. Throw. That's literally what it means. It means to throw onto Papa. Yeah.
Right.
Don't take it back.
Right.
Take immediate action when it comes to distractions and cares. Fling them upon the Lord. Guess I should have kept reading.
Yep.
Fling them upon the Lord. Can you say fling them upon the Lord?
Fling them upon the Lord.
Yes. He's got your best interest at heart, and he's got your back. Verse 8. Do not be intoxicated by cares. Keep your mind clear. Be wide awake. The fallen mindset would seek to snare and paralyze you with fear like a roaring lion. This system is in complete opposition to your righteousness. This system, the old mindset, the old man, it's in complete opposition to your righteousness. It would want to employ a sense of unworthiness and sin consciousness to question your righteousness. Right. Don't go there. Do not allow distractions to devour you.
Right.
That's key. The distractions, I mean, distractions just put you in a place of isolation. Distractions, they're meant to bring you to a place where you're alone. They're meant to get you into a place where you don't have any pillars. They're meant to bring you into a place where you don't have any support. We need support.
We need it.
Let me just tell you this. The minute, the second that you think you can do it by yourself, run for support. Run for it. Don't walk, run. Don't wait. Why wait? You want to rebuild? My wife tells me I'm really good at demo. I have a farmhouse that I've wrecked all the way down and have slowly built it back. She goes, man, you're really good at demo. Don't let any demo into your life. No demo. Say no.
No.
Demo.
No.
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 Demo. You don't need it.
Come on, that's good.
You've been built up.
Yep.
You are the living priest.
Amen.
You are the holy priest. You are what God built you to be. You don't need to be anything else. You don't need to be me. You don't need to be anybody here else. You are who you are by the grace of God. God has designed you to do what you need to do. But the moment that you feel isolated, the moment that you feel that you can do it yourself, run. Don't walk. So I love, I was sitting with Mike at breakfast the other day. I'm going to bring this up. He was asking me some questions. He asked me this one question, and then he reworded the question. And when he reworded this question, we both just started to cry. And it was just a help question. It was like, how can I help you? How can I pray for you? But the way he worded the question, it was like into my spirit. I hope that you have conversations like that with people. I hope that even when you're talking about winning a basketball championship, the conversation even turns then into how can I help you? How can I pray for you? What promises, I believe the question was, what promises do you have in your life that haven't come to fruition yet that I can pray for? Something along those lines. And I really appreciate that. But that question was just like, it sparked 20 years of a promise that God gave me that I haven't seen. And I don't know if I will, but I have hope. I have an expectation in my heart that it will happen. We just have to be patient. We have to wait upon the Lord. I preached about that last week in Auburn, and I was talking about the waiting, and I was talking about the abiding, but I was talking about being intimate with God. There's a reason why we wait. We kavar. We entwine ourselves. And then the abide, to stay present. Don't just come to church. You are the church. You are the living temple. Be the church. Be to someone something that you've never had.
Yeah, totally.
Share with them something that they need.
Yeah.
I just don't know if I want to go there. The humility thing is, it's so key. It's so key. Well, all right, I'm going to read it. I'm going to go to James 4. We'll just do one scripture. James 4, verse 10. I'll be in the mirror translation, but I love. Love how he phrases this. So James 4, verse 10 says, "Put down your own efforts to fight for your rights. Let him lift you up to the dignity of his presence." That word presence in there means in the gaze of, face to face. See, we think that if we turn and give the brother the other cheek, that God's going to exalt us to something. What's he going to exalt you to? Being better than that person? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We see that. It says, he will. I read it before. He will lift you high. Right? What does it mean? It means to be lifted into the presence, face to face with God. Abiding with him. To be present. To entwine. So when you get into those situations where it's like, well, I'm going to turn the other cheek because I'm going to be the bigger man. I'm going to be the better man. I'm going to be the better woman. Whatever it is, whoever you are, let God exalt you. Amen. Just let God exalt you. That only means to come up into the presence, in presence, face to face. It just means to be and abide with him. But as I was saying before, I guess I didn't finish my thought, sorry, was about the entwining and the abiding and to be present. Don't just come to church. But it comes with that entwining and to be present. It comes with a, what's the word I'm looking for? Devotion. Intimacy. That's what it is. An intimacy with God. That's what the entwining is all about. That's what the being present is all about. Being present in his presence. Stop going to God with a bucket list of things that you need.
Right.
He already knows what you need. Mm-hmm. And he's not worried about it.
No.
He even tells us in the word, don't be worried about anything.
Right.
He takes care of all the animals that you see. I often think about that. When it's freezing cold outside and you're watching stuff walk around.
Yeah.
That's a living out there. But he's designed it to work. But there's an intimacy with God that we need to get to and that we need to grow in. Don't stop. Don't stop being intimate with the Father. Don't stop entwining yourself with the Father. Don't stop being present in his presence. Don't stop being present here in this building. Don't stop being present with your family. Your family needs you. My wife told me this morning, Zoe needs me.
Yeah, I do.
See? She's talking about all the girls, and we're having this conversation. Don't you love those conversations, guys? Dads? And it's like, right when you're walking out the door, too, right? You're trying to leave and do something, and it's like, hey, about the girls. I need you to, Amy, if you're watching this, you know what I mean. I need you to do this. I'm like, right. I will. I'll do it. I'll be present. Dads, be present. Don't walk away. Your job is not to supply money and food on the table. Your job is to be present with your children. Amen. Okay. One last verse. We're coming in for a landing here. When I say verse, I mean whole chapter. But I've had so many conversations with a lot of the leaders in the house about this and people. I've preached about it before, but in Romans 12, if you want to go to verse 9, you want to scroll with me? Is that what Tony says? You want to scroll with me? Got your digital Bible? I do want to bring it in for a landing here, though, because this is so crucial. This is the, I don't want to say trick. What's the word? Like, I want to say recipe. It's no recipe. There's no algorithm. It just is. Yes, thank you. It's the way. The way. All right. Romans 12, verse 9. It says, let the inner movement of your heart always be to love one another and never play the role of an actor wearing a mask. Despise evil and embrace everything that is good and virtuous. Be devoted to tenderly loving your fellow believers as members of one family, trying to outdo yourselves in respect and honor of one another. Try to outdo yourselves in respect and honor of one another. I like that. Sorry, this is also the passion. Be enthusiastic to serve the Lord. Keep your passion towards Him boiling hot. Say boiling hot.
Boiling hot.
All right, next time you're in worship, I want to see you boiling hot.
Yeah, that's it.
Radiate with the glow. You know what? There's some people that tell me this too. They're like, well, that's just not me. It is you.
It is.
It is you.
It is.
It's like, oh, I'm just not an outgoing person. I don't worship big. You're here, you worship big.
Yeah.
You worship big. Why? Not because I tell you to. Because that's what you do.
Yeah.
That is the way.
Right.
That's the way. We worship big. If you haven't ever lifted your hands before, I dare you to lift your hands. I dare you to begin to trust God in worship.
Yes, yeah. Trust Him in worship.
There it is.
Just trust Him. He wants your trust.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Oh, boiling hot. Radiate with the glow of the Holy Spirit and let Him fill you with excitement as you serve Him.
Yeah.
Let this hope burst forth within you, releasing a continual joy. Don't give up in a time of trouble, but commune with God at all times.
Right.
Take a constant interest in the needs of God's beloved people and respond by helping them. And not just talking about Christians. God loves everyone. Okay. I just don't want you to be confused. Like you think, well, I got to help Mark. Help everyone. Your unsaved family members. Your unsaved friends. All at work. Help everyone. Help. And eagerly welcome people as guests into your home. How often have you had people over for dinner? Take a constant interest in the needs of God's beloved people and respond by helping them. And eagerly, I just read that. Whoops, I'm sorry. Maybe you need to hear it again. Take a constant interest in the needs of God's beloved people and respond by helping them. And eagerly welcome people as guests into your home. Speak blessings and not cursing over those who reject and persecute you. Celebrate with those who celebrate and weep with those who grieve. Live happily together in a spirit of harmony and be as mindful of another's worth as you are of your own. Don't live with a lofty mindset, thinking you're too important to serve others, but be willing to do menial tasks and identify with those who are humble-minded. Don't be smug or even think for a moment that you know it all. Never hold a grudge or try to get even, but plan your life around the noblest way to benefit others. Do your best to live as everybody's friend. Now let's go back to the beginning of chapter 12. Beloved friends, what should be our proper response to God's marvelous mercies? To surrender yourselves to God, to be His sacred, living sacrifices and live in holiness, experiencing all that delights his heart. For this becomes your genuine expression of worship. Stop imitating the ideals and opinions of the culture around you. Wow. There's a lot of people that need to hear that one. But be inwardly transformed by the Holy Spirit through a total reformation of how you think. This will empower you to discern God's will as you live a beautiful life, satisfying and perfect in his eyes. And that's the way. In verse 2. Be transformed. Be transformed. That word be means to exist. See, there's not a constant transformation. There's one transformation. And then there's application. And it's the application part. This is the part that's very like low on the totem pole for some people. It needs to be up top. Because we're not looking to keep on going from, like I preached last time I was here, from glory to glory. It's not about that. We were in a former glory. We were in Moses' glory. Now we're in the glory of righteousness. I don't want to go anywhere else. And my mind has been transformed. And now my mind needs to exist, transformed. There's already a reformation that's happened in my mind. Now it's keep the application coming. Keep the application. What does that mean? Well, I just read it. You can go right there. Romans 12. Just read Romans 12 once a day. Prescription right there. There's your RX. Prescription once a day. Just read it. Oh, this is how I exist transformed. Oh, I got to work my problems out with people. I need to help others. I need to invite people over for dinner. I need to be social. It's true. It's true. Being social is so vital. When I get to have a conversation with somebody, I can, in just a couple minutes, I can see right where they're at. And I know where to help, or I know where to stay away. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Amen. Just stand with me. I'm just going to pray and invite Pastor Bill back up, close us out here. Father, I just thank you that we can exist transformed.
Yeah.
Father, that you've given us the power. You've given us everything that we need. Father, I thank you for the friendships in this community, in this house. Yeah. Father, I thank you that friendships would build to another level.
Yes, I agree.
Father, I just thank you for bringing new people in and new friendships to blossom and bloom, Father.
Mm-hmm.
And Father, I thank you. I thank you for that palm branch. I thank you that I am an overcomer.
Yes.
Maybe you can say, I am an overcomer.
I am an overcomer.
I am triumphant. Father, I thank that even in the desert, that palm tree grows. Even if I found myself in the desert, I can still grow.
Mm-hmm.
I can still overcome. Father, I just speak blessings on everyone today. That whatever they're going through, they lift up to you. They cast all their cares on you, Father, because you care for them. And then you keep it. That we would never have to struggle with that thing again.
I agree.
Thank you, Father, that we're able to conquer mountains. We're able to move mountains. Thank you for the faith that you've given us, that we can vigorously go after anything that we need to attack in our own lives, Father. Amen.
Your goodness is running after. It's running.